come, hear the tale of our ragtag crew, brought together upon a mysterious island by fate. They have lost, they have won, and now, alongside a rebel faction, the truth on the wind, they fight against the evil Eterlines. Behind it all, an alien being of immeasurable power begins to rise once again. As the land grows cold, our party stands as a light in the darkness. Now, welcome to the Swordcast Adventure.
Previously on the Swordcast Adventures, we found ourselves in the company of a Goliath tribe in the Demoni Mountains. They seemed like a close family. They spoke highly of each other and seemed to treat one another with much respect. We drank with them as we feasted and listened to their stories of hardship due to this molten scourge. As they spoke, they adorned one another with highly detailed tattoos of past triumphs. Their leader offered the services of the Ink Giver to adorn our skin with the symbol of our tribe if we so wished it. We thought about it for a good while, but then I knew just what we needed. While the others received their marks, I shared what memories I had of Loud Scout. I never met him, but from what I saw of him, he didn't deserve to be wrapped up in all of this. He didn't even get to find out he had joined a fight much more important than he could have ever dreamed. The following morning, we parted ways with the tribe and continued south towards the volcano. Shortly after midday, the smell of sulfur hit the air as we came upon pools of tainted water and even more pools of molten rock. As we passed through, a horde of fiery serpents arose from the molten rock to assail us. We must be getting close to the dragon's lair.
As you all have now been within this fight for quite some time, a few of the fire creatures have fallen, but many continue to fight along their companions and against you all.
Wait, how many rounds is it? It's only been like one or two rounds, right?
Just like two rounds.
I think two, yeah.
Was it two?
Two?
I thought it might have only been one, actually. Because
I'm pretty sure it's only one. Oh, okay. I just listened to it this morning.
So a while being 6 seconds?
A while being 6 seconds. That's a long fucking time.
Yeah.
So, as you all find yourself in the middle of this flaming royal, you begin once again at the top of the round. Elduin, your party is slowly but surely being surrounded by these creatures of flame. What do you do?
I would like to prevent said flanking maneuver. I will, out of the corner of my eye, catch these smaller snakes trying to circle around behind my friends. Yes, the snakes behind us, and I will level with squinted eyes at them my bow and fire.
Okay.
Hiya.
Hiya.
That's probably so. I'm always doing sharpshooter, so that's an 8 to hit. So that's probably gonna miss.
It does miss. Your bow, your arrow goes flying wide over.
Would like to use my bonus action to redirect it towards the second one behind me.
Not a problem.
How about a... one. Natural one.
A natural one? Your arrow goes quickly off kilter and straight into the sulfur pool next to it and disappears into the depths.
Okay, so on that note, I'm going to fire my second shot. At the first one.
All right. Ooh, that
looks
like
a 23 to hit.
I think a 23 could do the job.
All right, so that is going to be 21 magical piercing and 2 cold damage.
Right, so as your first arrow flies wide, missing the first snack, flying over the second and delving into the depths near these two creatures, your second arrow hits true and digs itself deep within this creature's form. The ice peels over its molten skin as the creature just shrieks and crumbles and falls in front of you.
Yeah. I'm going to aggressively step in front of Actually, no. I'm gonna start moving forward. One, two. I'm gonna fire my third arrow at the remaining flanker.
Yes.
For a, damn it, an 11 to hit.
11 misses.
All right. Well, I think that this guy should not, in fact, be attacking my more arcane friend. So I'm going to just move into melee combat with this guy.
Excellent. Could you also roll me just a D100 and call higher or low for me?
A D100.
Uh-oh. These are always good.
These are always good. Let's go high.
Okay.
51.
The arrow skims over the snake's head and lands in the shore next to the pool. Right over here. So it is not lost. Anything else?
Somehow still hits Griptuck.
I will. Nope. Nothing. Nothing else.
We move to the next.
I steal myself to dodge a snake attack, but you know, that's for flavor. I'm not actually doing anything.
A sneaky snake attack?
Mm-hmm.
Got it. Grimtuck, as you are being harried on either side by these giant just creatures of living flame, not exactly elementals, but their fins on the back of their necks and down their tails move and weave between each other like flame itself. As these two stand on either side, a snake comes to you and attacks.
All right, make sure that it's with advantage, because you know I'd be going reckless and shit.
You know I'd be going reckless. yes, it is with advantage. That's a 16 to hit you.
That doesn't hit.
Its bite, as it leaps forward to bite you, you step just out of the way and it lands with a splat in front of you. It then whips around with its tail. 17.
Also does not hit.
You step back just in time as this snake of decent size whips its tail around trying to crack you in the side, able to deftly dodge out of the way.
I'm janky.
A little janky. We move on to Amelia's turn.
Sure do.
Metolius, you're up next.
So Amelia would like to kind of stand up from where she's crouching down and did you hit this on your turn, Metolius, the guy in front of you?
I cast Protection from Energy and then he came up and tried to hit me but did not make contact.
That is right. Will you refresh my memory, Roz? Which ones have been hit?
You have seen this creature been hit. Has been hit.
Okay.
This creature has been hit. And that's it.
Amelia is going to stand up from where she is, and she is going to point a finger at this big guy here in between Rain and Grimtuck. Mm-hmm. And then she's going to kind of just flick her finger out like she's flicking a bell, but there's nothing there, and then this thing just hears a bell ring inside its head and she casts Toll the Dead.
Toll the Dead! Yes, the creature now standing between Rain and Grimtuck hears that clang sound.
It's a wisdom saving throw.
That's a natural one.
Beautiful. Hell kabong.
Hell kabong.
Hell kabong. You done told.
That's a good one.
21 necrotic damage.
Woo! The creature just like starts to whip back and forth. You see this oddly darker orange red kind of liquid start to pool out of what you can only guess to be ears and a little out of the sockets underneath its eyes.
Amelia then crouches back down and she's going to circle back around this pile of rocks that she's next to.
Sounds good. Petolius.
I raise my axe and I strike the creature.
Do it.
That's for a 24.
24 hits.
6 lightning damage, 2 radiant damage, 11 slashing.
6 lightning, 2 radiant, 11 slashing?
So 19 total.
Weird. So as you strike this creature with your axe, you feel something odd. As you crash into it with your axe, your hand burns as you feel this blaze of heat as you get closer and closer to this creature. You take 7 points of fire damage.
Reduced to 3.
Hey.
Because I have protection from energy. Oh, that takes away from my temporary hit points too. But I'd still have to make concentration check. And I pass it with a 16.
Oh yeah, you do.
And then I strike it again. Oh, yeah, it did do the cold last time. Yeah, lightning last time. So disregard the lightning on this one. So okay. It's actually 17 points of damage.
Sounds good. So you wheel back, and with a second grand slash across the creature, you take away 17
points. And I would also like to smite it.
Okay.
For an additional 17 points of damage as I do a level 1 smite.
As you peel your axe across its chest, you pump your radiant glow through it, and it explodes as you connect. But once again, as your axe slides through the creature, you feel that same burn as you take now 10 reduced to 5 points of fire damage.
No, my temp HPs. 22 con save. I am good.
You are good.
I believe that brings my turn to an end. I believe I would slide over to block this creature from getting to Amelia.
Okay, sounds good.
The larger creature.
As you sidle over to join your companion here in the middle of this fray, standing next to Rain, blocking the creature in front of Rain, in between Rain and Grimtuck, the large salamander rises up with its spear, and taking advantage of the fact that he that Grimtuck is sandwiched between his he and his companion, stabs deep into Grimtuck with advantage. 22 to hit you.
That one hits.
That is, with two hands, that is 14 points of piercing damage and 1 fire. So 7 and 1 fire, if I'm not mistaken.
Okay, that's, yep, sounds good.
Okay. Then followed closely as it makes this stab, you feel the sharp pain and the burn of the spear enter into your shoulder. As it rips it out, you hear the stones behind you shift as this creature tries to smack you with its tail. 23 to hit.
Oh yeah, man, he's doing good tonight. That hits.
As you feel this just gigantic tail crash into you for 16, reduced to 8 points of bludgeoning damage, you then feel the heated body of the creature wrap around you and burn with 10 points. You also, as you feel that occur, the tail wraps all the way around and you feel it tighten and grab hold as you are grappled.
All right, how much damage was that total? I'm sorry.
Total was 26. Ooh. Or actually, no, 18, because 8 bludgeoning, 10 fire.
Gotcha.
The fire is reduced too, because he's totem.
Oh, yeah.
Oh, it's true. So that actually, you only got 6 fire in the total of the 2 attacks.
Okay.
But you are grappled.
And now, which one is the guy at the north, south, or the east?
The guy at the north. Gotcha.
Okay.
The guy that you also have flanking upon because you're in between, he's in between you and Rain to the north.
Okay.
Is it two? This gentleman's turn. At the very south of the battlefield, the other of these gigantic, odd flame lizard-like creatures kind of roll around and spins through and makes it. Let's see. There we go. He actually kind of splashes into this water. As he does, I would like you, Grimtuck, to make a dexterity saving throw, please.
Okay. Oh, I fucking killed it on that one. That would be 20. It's not bad, actually. 23.
You move just enough out of the way so that the heated water splashing as this creature moves towards you doesn't spray you.
Does he take any damage, it looks like, from the water?
You don't seem to notice it. You can roll a medicine check if you want.
Okay. I probably don't know. 8.
8? Can't tell.
Darn it.
As he stands there at the edge of this water, though, he takes the opportunity and stabs at you with his spear. That's 23 to hit.
That hits.
With two hands, you feel his heated spear stab into you with 8 points of piercing damage and 1 point of fire. So 9 points altogether.
All right.
He pulls back, and as he does, his tail also spins around, and with an extra slathering of this just terrible, awful-smelling water, he tries to smack you while being still held by his friend.
Ah, the old stink tail.
The old stink tail. 24 to hit.
24 hits.
That is a total of 7, effectively 7 points of bludgeoning and 2 points of fire damage.
All right.
But again, you are already grappled and he is unable to do so.
Yep.
Elwin, in front of you, the snake reels up and tries to bite down upon you as you meet its gaze.
Bring it, snack.
Bring it, snack. 13.
Misses.
He then wheels around with the tail with an 8 and misses terribly as he kind of slides his tail underneath. Followed by Metolius, the creature in front of you that you have just dealt a deft blow to, now tries to reciprocate in kind. That is a natural 1 to hit. So he dives in with his spear, but you're able to thrust your shield up just in enough time. And as you do, spear slides across. You feel the heat through the metal, but you're able to allow it to do no harm to you as it just slaps it out of the way. I would actually allow you to make a attack of opportunity because of his natural 1, if you so wish to use your action at this moment.
I wish to do that.
Okay.
That is going to be an 18.
18 to hit.
Or no, that's 20 to hit, but 18 damage.
18 damage. You follow up as you throw your shield off. This creature's spear stabs into the ground. You swing up as he exposes his side and connects right in his side between his arm and his torso. 18 points of damage to this wonderful Lizardy's fire boy.
How much fire damage do I take?
You take 5 points. So 2 points of fire damage. And keep your
calm. Yep.
Hell yeah.
No, my temp HP.
Oh, no.
It's gone. It's gone.
But he tries to follow that up. As he basically lands holding his spear down, he takes the opportunity and looks over at you and swings his wide tail towards you. 16 to hit.
No,
I didn't think so. You just are able to step back in enough time to watch the tail whiz by, the heat barely singeing the edges of your beard, which sadly are not a magical armor.
You fucked up now, bro.
You done goofed, bro. You done goofed.
Not my fine half-elf in beard.
That is the end of his turn. Instead, this little sneck does his best to get over to the melee. He is going to rush in with... Yep, he's going to rush in and not be able to do anything yet. Actually, he's going to swim across this. Dude, let's see how far he can get. Dude. He begins to swim across. You hear a splash as this decently sized snake starts swimming through this tepid and terrifying pool.
It's a decent sized snake.
It's a decent snake.
It's a decent size.
They told me it was decent size.
It's fine, man. It's fine.
Yeah. Yeah. Grimtuck, it's your turn.
The guy is grappling me. I am just going to do my reckless... Yep. My reckless axe attacks on him. See if I could talk him out of this.
You should definitely talk him out of it.
Yeah.
You're reckless because you're... Oh, are you still flanking even though you're grappled?
I think so.
Yeah.
Yeah, okay, then you're right.
You don't have reckless if you don't want to.
Word. Good looking out.
Yeah.
Oh, that certainly hits with a 28 to hit.
Yeah, it hits.
All right. Wait, no, minus 5. So, yeah, that would be still a pretty high number. So, yeah.
Yeah, 23 hits. Let's just say that.
Oh, damn. That's good damage. 11, 12, 13, 14, 15, 16, 17, 18, 19,
29. 29. Points of damage?
Yeah, great. We're doing...
Oh, yeah.
Great Weapon Master.
Let's double checking. Sweet. He is still up. Would you like to continue?
Yeah, absolutely. Okay. That one might not. That is 17... 12. 12
to hit. Oh, does not hit.
She's a harsh mistress, that Great Weapon Master.
As you swing in, connect with your connect into this creature and take a large cut into his torso, you feel the tail tighten and kind of pull you to one side. So as you make that second swing, he's out of your range as your attack goes wide.
All right. I would say obviously it couldn't do it as an action, but just for flavor, I would try and just see if I can break free of this tail bullshit. Which I understand is an action, so I'm just more like trying to get out of the fucking, like, wiggle out of the way kind of bullshit.
You also take a total of 4 points of fire damage on your turn.
Eat shit!
That's not true. You take a total of 7 points of fire damage on your turn. One for the hit you made, and the second because you're wrapped around its tail.
All right, cool.
Or its tail is wrapped around you.
All right. I'm good.
Sick. That makes it Rain's turn.
All right. I am going to attack the guy, the big guy that I'm flanking with Grimtuck. The guy who's grabbing him.
The salamander to the south of you.
That'll be 19.
Hits.
Sneak attack. Two, six, nine, 15, 18, 21, plus 6, 27 piercing damage.
Wart, how would you like to do this?
Nice. Just stick my rapier in its back. And then after it comes through the other side, if it makes it all the way through, just kind of stop short of, like, Grimtuck being grappled.
Okay. Sounds good. So you look over as this creature screeches out, Grimtuck, and you see Rain's rapier just, like, come straight through its chest right at your face and just stops, like, about an inch and a half.
Ha! I'll just spit in its eye.
As you spit in its eye and you feel its tail loosen around you and fall to the ground as the creature just tumbles down.
Nice. Kick it into the fucking
your
water.
Your spit hits it and sizzles.
Nice.
Okay.
And then I am going to, I guess right now I'm just going to come around this side, so I'm give Metolius flanking on this snake right here.
Okay. Sounds good.
And that's my turn.
Sweet. Speaking of that snake right there is going to see what you did and wheel around towards you and try to bite down upon you.
Got it.
14 to hit.
Does not hit.
You jump out of the way as its jaws come snapping down at your leg. Moving just enough, it then spins its tail trying to catch you as you deftly dodge its first attack. 22 to hit you.
That hits.
It's you feel its tail crack into you and bring you down. Then you hear the sizzle of your flesh as the fire begins to burn. Total of 7 points of damage. Three bludgeoning, 2 fire effectively, which is the halved 4.
Okay, so 4 altogether?
Yeah. No, 5 altogether.
5 altogether, got it.
Does the snake attack with disadvantage? Because she has her cloak.
Oh, it's true.
Truth. I always forget to remind you of that.
and I rolled 22s for both of those, so It was meant to be.
Meant to be. Got it.
Okay. Bringing it to the creature to the south of Grimtuck as this this large beast rises up with its spear trying to stab down at him. We're no longer grappled. He does not have advantage. Because you didn't reckless last time. You didn't have to.
Correct.
So he stabs down at you with a 9.
Nope.
The spear just pierces the ground, but as he does, as before, this creature takes this opportunity and swings around with his tail. 25.
That one hits.
Okay. That, as you feel the tail connect, that similar sensation of it wrapping and warping around you and holding you tight.
Dick
and hugging
move.
You on cold nights.
God damn it.
You feel loved. 7 points of bludgeoning damage, 4 points of fire damage, and you are grappled once again.
All right.
But that is its turn. We bring it to the top of the round. Elduin, you now stand in front of this fiery snake as another similar one seems to be trying to swim towards you.
Got it. I am going to this thing feels like it could probably reach me about 5 feet or so away from itself.
Yes.
Cool.
Yes.
I'm gonna step over here. Go ahead. Do your thing. Okay.
It's got a 17.
That hits.
Okay. As you try to step away from it, it wheels around quickly and its large fang jaws clamp down on you. You feel 5 points of piercing damage as the teeth rake against, and then the wound burns and cauterizes instantly as you take 5 points of fire damage. So 10 altogether.
No, my temp HP.
No.
Okay, so now that I am outside of its melee range, I would like to put an arrow in its face.
Okay.
So, aiming at it with disdain, that is a 19.
19 hits.
Great. So that is going to be 21 points of piercing damage plus 3 cold.
this creature never saw it coming as one quick shot from your bow just pierces straight through its entire body. The small, almost spark-like effect of the frost at the very end moment of its life surrounding its jaw as it falls over, the ice melts, and the creature dies.
Excellent. Excellent. I will take steps back, and I'm going to shoot this fish in a barrel.
Ah, yes.
The one that is swimming towards me.
Yes.
It's at the surface, right?
It is at the surface, yes. Cool.
How about a 12 to hit?
12 doesn't hit.
Okay. I would like to use my bonus action to redirect that arrow to one of to the big salamander that is,
the one in the pool or the one at?
Yeah, the one in the pool.
Okay.
So, that one. How about a 30 to hit?
Yes.
Great. That one is going to take 8 piercing damage.
Okay.
And I think I am going to actually use one of my arcane shots on this one. I think it should make a charisma saving throw.
Ah, yes. They're excellently charismatic.
Mm-hmm. I suspect this
18.
Much.
18.
Yeah.
18. Oh. Well,
this one tried to talk me into an MLM, so he's pretty fucking slick.
crap. Where does my spell save DC on D&D Beyond?
Go to the spell tab.
Mm-hmm. I'm in the spells tab. It's not.
Click on the spell you're casting or whatever the spell is.
Wait, maybe it's here? But it's not a normal spell. Oh, there it is. It's in line. Okay, yes, it makes it. It just takes the 8. I've used one of my arcane shots. All right, anyways, I'm going to use my last shot to shoot the fish in the barrel again.
Yes.
Yeah. Another 19 for 12... More, nope, 22 more piercing damage.
22? As you fire this shot at the fish in the barrel for the second time, the creature like wheels up and ready to strike. And as you do, it gives you the perfect opportunity and your arrow just pierces straight through its body.
Yeah.
As the creature screeches out in this moment of pain, it then slumps down and starts to sink to the bottom. Yeah.
Just like shooting snakes in a fire pit.
Yeah. Sure.
All right. Anyways, that's all. I'm done.
Okay.
Elf, bow out.
Bow out. Okay. This creature kind of moves around and tries to find its way up to Rain. Rain, this snake snakes its way up to you.
As they will.
As they do.
As they do.
Trying to bite down at you. As it is already well and injured, it harmlessly snaps its jaws at you with a 10.
Does not hit.
Hitting its face into the ground in this miss, trying to deal any amount of damage, it takes that opportunity using its jaw as a brace and flicks its tail back at you. 16.
Does not hit.
And it is helplessly left upon the ground, not actually prone, but not able to do any amount of damage. Move to Amelia.
Okay. So Amelia is going to step around this way, mm-hmm. and she is going to reach into her pouch, and she pulls out a small dried out eyeball.
Ooh, okay.
As she kind of just like flicks it into the flames of this guy here. and where it hits, you see the flames, it kind of sizzles and cracks and pops when it hits, and then the flames in that small section of it turn black as you cast Hex upon it.
Ooh, solid, solid.
And then she's going to, again, kind of just take her fingers and flick into the air as she casts Toll the Dead on this one.
Okay. On the one,
right to the right of Metolius.
Uh-huh. It's after you and the right of Metolius.
Mm-hmm.
Got this.
So that's going to be a Wisdom save.
Yeah. That's a natural one.
Oh, good.
Good. Nice.
Ooh. Necrotic damage, as well as an extra 5 from the Hex, so 30 necrotic damage total.
Shit. Seriously, holy. Holy hell. The creature just, its head flails to each side.
Oh, and I'm going to choose dexterity for him to have disadvantage on checks on.
Okay, do I have a foot? There it is, that one. Okay, sounds good. You see this creature just like flailing its head back and forth, that kind of just crackling, basically the sound of a large bonfire just echoes out from its mouth as more of that like darker reddish liquid starts to pour out of the orifices on its face.
Good. And then Amelia just steps back behind the pile of rocks that she was behind.
Sounds good.
That's her turn.
We bring it to Metolius.
Metolius would first turn his attention. How bad does the big guy look?
He doesn't look great. He's now bleeding from pretty much every hole on his face.
Oh, well. Well, how about I just make my own? And swing.
Hey, yo. Okay.
That's going to be a 15 to hit.
15 hits.
15 hits?
15 hits.
He takes 24, and I'll throw a level 1 Divine Smite in there.
Okay.
Oh, wonderful. 29.
29. Sounds good. You also take 2 points. Are 4 reduced to 2.
Okay.
As you connect into this creature's blazing hot body.
It's so hot. Is it still alive?
It is still alive.
All right. Well, in an effort to just remove people from the board, I'll strike the snake to the south of me.
Okay.
With my axe on the second strike. Oh, yeah. That's like a 28.
That definitely hits.
And 24 points of damage.
With one quick swing, your axe cuts straight through this creature. You take a total of 2 points, 4 reduced to 2. Make your concentration check.
I have to make 2 of them, so let me make the first one.
Yeah.
Yep.
Okay,
and
make the first.
The second one. I did. I pass.
You good? Okay, you take 2 points of fire damage as you connect, as you basically like slash into this creature, and then I see you just wheeling back and turning just enough to slam your axe through the creature that is to the north of Rain. You also would get advantage, actually.
I will roll again for crit's sake.
For crit's sake?
No. Okay.
Nope, you connect, and as you do, you just slash straight through this creature, splitting it in half. Your hand burns from the body itself, but the creature just falls and crumples down dead.
Then I would rotate my body. I would rotate around the creature in front of me so to draw his attention away from Grimtuck and Rain.
Sounds good. Anything else?
Nope. I think he would, yeah, just look around to Amelia and Eldwyn, see that they're all right, and just continue face tanking this guy. And that's okay. The end of my turn.
As you finish your turn, Metolius, the creature within the pool just pushes forward and hits land. The sulfuric water just drips off of him as he stands. You hear a sizzle as his heated body begins to throw that steam into the air, and the smell fills your nostrils, Rain, as he begins his assault upon you. With a spear, it's a 10. Oh, he gets advantage. An 11! Got 11 advantage. And that works.
He also gets disadvantage for my cloak. Keep in mind.
So with a 10, that would just be in an average roll. He does not hit you. As he stabs down, he then tries his darndest to swing his tail and connect somehow. 21 to hit you.
That does hit.
You take a total of 11 bludgeoning damage as you feel the weight of his tail wrap and tighten around you, grappling you. You also feel and hear sizzle as your body burns for 3 points of fire damage.
And then halved.
That is halved.
That is 7 already halved. Got it.
Halved to 3. But then you become grappled as he holds tightly upon you.
Got it.
And that is that guy's turn. Then Metolius, the creature that still stands just barely, tries his hand at attacking you. A 19 to hit?
Nope.
Just stabs down, missing entirely. He then tries, as he pulls his spear back, you see the tail come whipping out from its side, trying to catch you off guard. A non-natural 20.
A not-natural 20. But I'm so lucky.
But I'm so lucky.
He rolls a nat 1 instead.
Well, in that vein, as the threads of fate change this from being a decent strike upon you to now throwing this creature off balance, already in pain, already hurt, he wheels his tail up and opens his whole torso to you, allowing for an attack of opportunity if you wish to take it.
Wait, do I have advantage? No, I'm not. I'm gonna luck that too.
Okay.
I think it does. I have a feeling it doesn't hit. So 17
hits.
That's 17 points
of
damage.
So as this creature just basically sprawls himself in front of you, the tail whipping out, his body extending in trying to connect with you, opening its torso, you just come down with a swift strike of your axe, just eviscerating it. And its hot internal organs just spray across the ground and sizzle as they hit the air. You take a total of 12, reduced to 6 points of fire damage from connecting with it.
And make a con save. I make it.
Excellent. But this creature does not, as he falls and crumples to the ground, lifeless. We move on to Grimtuck.
All right. You can set a watch to what I'm going to do. Pretty consistently. This guy that's grappling me, Reckless, Great Weapon Master.
Okay.
Ah, shit. Fourteen hit?
14 does not.
Shit! Alright. One more time. That one does a lot better. That'll be 19.
19?
Yep.
Does it.
Nine, 10, 11, 12, 22 damage. Mm-hmm.
Creature just slashed and a bit of blood sprays on you and you feel it burn as you take a total of 2 points of fire damage from the blood spray, but as the tail is still wrapped around you, you take a total of 3, so 5 fire damage altogether.
Okay. That's all I got.
That's all you got? Okay.
That's all I got.
We bring it back to Rain's turn. Rain, you're now being flanked on both in east and west here.
Yeah. Is the salamander that came up out of the water, is he in melee with Grimtuck, or is Grimtuck a little too far away?
He is effectively in melee with Grimtuck.
So if I came around, we would be flanking?
Yes.
Okay, got it. And you said the little snake guy is not looking great?
Nope.
Okay, I'm going to go ahead and attack him then.
Okay.
In hopes of clearing him off the board. I won't get sneak attack though, will I?
No.
Okay, never mind. I'm going to disengage, use my bonus action to disengage with the snake, come around and flank the salamander and attack him.
Okay.
Wait, aren't you grappled though?
You are grappled, actually.
Was I grappled?
Yeah, because this guy hit you.
Right. Never mind. Let's see. I guess I will just attack the little guy then.
Okay.
Let's see. I'll just use... I think either of the dice I just rolled would have hit, so if you don't mind if I use that. Let's see. There we go. So I'll use the lower of the two. It would be a 25.
That does hit.
Excellent. So then we're looking at, ooh, at least max damage. That works. So 14. Yeah.
What do you mean at least max damage?
Well, because I didn't get, I couldn't use my sneak attack. So at least I got max damage on only getting to roll one die.
And you're talking you attack the snake to your east, correct?
Yes. Like okay. The one that you said was not looking great. Yeah.
Yes. Okay, yeah. In an instant, your rapier stabs through it. It screeches out in that crackling sound and falls.
Excellent.
Mm-hmm. But as you stab into the creature, you take a total of 2 points of fire damage that's already reduced from the snake you just killed.
Got it.
And you feel your body burn as the tail still wrapped around you tightly tries to burn you away with 4, which is already reduced as well.
Got it.
Anything else?
And I'm still grappled currently?
You are still grappled.
Okay, got it. Nope, that's it.
Okay. Grimtuck, the creature that you just attacked tries to come back in with a similar repercussion as he stabs in at you with a 16 to hit.
No dice.
Stabbing down and missing, the tail swings in with a natural 20.
Question.
Answer.
I'm grappled by that same tail.
Oh, you are. Sorry. I apologize. He's going to swing in with the spear. That's another natural 20.
Wow. Good for him.
Whoa.
Feeling good.
Grimtuck, are you okay? Are you okay?
I'm fucking legit, dude.
So that is 16. That is 30. So that's 40 points of damage altogether, halved to 20.
Yeah, I mean, it's a solid hit, but I'm just, again, just spit my own blood on him. Like... This is nothing compared to the fucking wyvern fight where I'm just like literally drenched in my own blood.
Yeah.
So, yeah, I'm still
No,
good.
This creature stabs down into you again, smiling with this crackling smile. Its fins and like basically fronds just move with it as it wheels about. But you also take a total of 5 points from being grappled by this creature.
Okay.
And that is its turn. Eldwin.
I would like to fire many arrows into the back of this one that's right in front of me.
Excellent. All right, at the edge of the pool, the one that is grappling Rain, you fire many arrows into.
Yes. So, first one is a 14 to hit.
14 misses.
Misses. I will redirect that to the one grappling Grimtuck.
Okay.
For a 16.
A 16?
Mm-hmm.
16 hits.
Sweet. That would be 12 piercing and 4 cold to that guy.
Okay.
And then I will fire another arrow at the first guy.
Sounds like a plan.
Damn it. That's a 13.
A 13 does not hit.
Okay. I cannot redirect that one, but I will fire my last
shot. Flying off.
At it. Another 19.
19 hits.
So that is going to be 22 magic piercing damage with solid arrow in the back.
Okay. Around you, Grimtuck, Rain, you hear the sounds of Elduin's attack as two arrow bolts just connect into your attackers. As they roil about, as the arrows begin to just kind of singe at the edges, another goes flying off. Anything else, Elduin?
Nope. All done.
Excellent. Amelia.
I'm a Gatling gun.
Yeah, I mean, pretty much. at least you know your place.
Amelia is going to step around the eastern side of this rock pile here.
Excellent.
Again, and she's going to walk up and stand next to Metolius. Mm-hmm. And as she looks down at this dead salamander's body, and as she does, she kind of holds out a hand and then like makes a raising motion with it. And as she does, the black flames that were burning upon it lift off of the salamander. And she kind of holds it there for a moment as she points out at the one grappling Rain. The black streak flies forward and slams into this one, and where it hits, the flames licking off of it turn black as she moves the hex onto it.
Boom.
And then she makes the same kind of flicking motion in the air as she casts Hold the Dead.
And are we going to do dexterity again?
I'm going to do strength on this one.
Okay. Sounds good. Wisdom saving throw from this creature. Mm-hmm. That's a 10. That doesn't make it.
That does not make it. That is 15 from Toll the Dead. And then 1 from Hex. So 16 total.
Excellent. Once again, in front of you, Rain, this creature, pieces of it begin to crack as its scales begin to break, and bits of that deep, deep crimson burning kind of pool down. Anything else, Amelia?
That is it.
Metolius.
Yeah, here I come. A smiting.
Here I come, a smite.
Let's see. How far can I move? 30 feet. If I could make it there and flank with Grimtuck, I think I would do that. Mm-hmm. Tullius runs over and strikes. Seven. Oh, that's with advantage. So hold on. Okay. First one, 16, does 22 points of damages.
Okay. Are you doing any form of smiting?
Not on this attack.
Then you are going to take he is still up, and you are going to take a total of 3 points. That is already halved.
Okay, and then make a concentration check. I pass. Mm-hmm. Then I'm going to roll with advantage, so a 19 so 29.
29 hits.
for 21 points of damage, and I will level 2 Divine Smite on top of that.
Okay.
So 36 points of damage.
Sounds good. The creature is still up, but large just gouges cut through his back scales. His blood bubbles as it touches him. And you also take another 11 reduced to 5 points of fire damage from hitting this creature.
5 damage and concentration check. I pass.
Excellent.
As long as I don't roll a 1 or a 2, I'm gonna pass. So, I would call out to Grimtuck, take your shot! And that's the end of my turn.
Okay.
Dramatic.
Yes. The creature is going to wheel about and try and attack you as you have just dealt it a decent blow, Metolius. First, with a stab of 23.
Ow. That hits.
Okay. With two-handed into this, it's 13 points of piercing damage and 6 reduced to 3, so 16 points altogether.
Thank you. I will roll a con save in just a second.
And then another 4. A 4 for flame. Oh no, that's never mind. I'm adding too many. Just okay. What I said originally. But he is going to use his spear once again and try to hit you for a 21.
Sure.
15.
Yep.
15 points, 16 altogether with the halved fire damage. He comes down almost feral now as 2 strikes from his spear connect into Metolius. He trying to stay alive, but still grappling and within this mess that has become the battlefield. You succeed, you move to Grimtuck.
All right, well, I'm never one to miss an opportunity. So, yeah, I'm gonna try and fuck up this guy. Hold on a sec here. I'll get through my items real quick.
Also take 3 points of fire damage.
All right.
Being grappled.
Just for being a dick. All right, I'll just yell out, "Hell's take you, fucker!" And swing. That would be 20, dropping it down to 15 to hit.
15 hits.
Sweet. And 16, 17, 18,
19,
29 damage.
29?
Yep.
He is still up, but barely. He's leaning against his spear, trying to hold himself still high. Barely holding on to rain.
These guys are durable as shit. Okay, then,
you also... Sorry, you take... From hitting him, you take 3 points of fire damage that's already reduced.
I'll stack it all up and just grab it at the end. 3 there. Okay. And then that would be not natural 20 for the next one.
That hits.
And that's 7... 20 damage.
20 damage. As this creature is barely holding on, he leaves himself open to a wide attack as you come down with the first slice and then follow through with a final swing. Its head goes clean off and wheels through the sky as it splashes into the pool next to it. Its body falls. Rain, you are no longer grappled. And Grimtuck, over the course of the entirety of the... Over the course of the entire exchange, you take a total of... 3, 6, and 8 points of fire damage that's already halved.
Okay.
His body now lays half in the water still. The water around him boils. And that is your turn?
That's my turn. That's all I got because I'm still grappled by the other dude.
You are still grappled. Rain. You go.
Right. I'm going to come around the other side and grapple the guy to the south of Grimtuck.
Grapple him?
Or grapple him. I meant flank him. Sorry.
All right. I'm
gonna grab on.
Flank is going.
Fuck it. I can take it.
That actually, weird, guys.
That actually checks out with Rain's behavior.
Let's see. 4A. 26 to hit.
26 hits.
Twenty-eight, so 34 slash or piercing damage.
34?
Yep.
Skadoosh. The creature, you just stab straight through the creature's torso. It screeches out in that same odd language, but it still stands, breathing heavily. You take a total of 4 points, which is already halved.
Got it.
Papaya damage. Anything else, Rain?
No, I'll stay and keep flanking.
Okay. As it becomes the creature's turn, Grimtuck, you feel the tail wrapping around you loosen and unfurl as this creature just begins to run.
Oh. I am going to, if I get an opportunity attack, I'm going to try and grapple him.
Okay. Counter grapple.
Yeah, fuck that. You're Objection. Going nowhere. You're right.
Get back here.
Yeah, no, that's a spicy one right there. That
you
is.
Can hug me and not finish the job?
That's a 25.
Whoa. He is going to try and acrobatics out of the way. That actually, that's a natural 20. Wait.
Yeah, it's but a, what is it up to?
It's an ability check for 22. So I'm not gonna. Ah, oh, it's so hard. No, the ability check did not meet.
Yeah.
You succeeded.
Tight. Yeah. Fuck that guy. Sizzly hot hug. I'm going for it.
Please don't at me, internet.
No, you're doing it right. What are you talking about?
Yeah, that's legit.
Okay, yeah, no, this creature tries to run. In your opportunity attack, you stay his course. Which yeah,
lots of
I would
fucker.
Say does not allow Rain to make an opportunity attack because
right,
he never
that's what
leaves
I was gonna ask.
Melee combat. Well, actually, no, because he would leave 5 feet. He would never leave melee combat with you, Rain.
Right.
As Grimtuck pulls him back. Okay. So, Grimtuck, you got him grappled by the tail, question mark?
Yeah, sure. That's legit. Whatever you say.
You take half of 6, so 3 points of fire damage as you grab onto this creature's just burning body and hold it there in place. That is its it tried to run, it failed, so it's going to wheel around and try to just stab people.
Nice.
Rain, it stabs out at you with a 17 to hit, with a two-handed spear attack.
Yep.
Matches 15 points of piercing damage, and effectively 1 point of fire, so 16 altogether.
Got it.
Oh, wait, I get a disadvantage, sorry.
Yes.
Nope, that's a 10.
Never mind.
He then wheels around and tries to hit Grimtuck behind him.
I would too.
26 to hit you.
That hits.
That's 17. So effectively, 8 points? Or, yeah. 8 points of piercing damage and 1 point of fire damage. So 9 points altogether as he stabs out at you with two hands.
Sweet.
But unable to get away. And you also take... Nope, already gave the fire damage, so yeah. Nope, this creature is just roiling and thrashing around, trying to get out of your grasp, and unable to do so, as it is now grappled.
Ha!
We move to Elduin. Elduin, you see Grimtuck grab this creature by the tail and pull him back. He is now held.
I would like to shoot it in the fleshy bits.
In the fleshy bits? That's a lot of them.
Mm-hmm. All right. A standard, you know, magic, and well, that's gonna miss. So second shot. 22.
22 hits.
All right. So that is going to be 16 magical piercing plus 4 cold for 20 magical damages.
The creature screeches out as you see the ice crystals flow across its back as the arrow pierces through its body. But it is still up.
I will fire my third shot.
Do it.
That is a 16 to hit.
That hits.
22 more magical piercing damage.
Woo! A second thuck in the back of the creature's body as it stiffens for a moment at the pain, but continues to try to wheel around and get out of your grasp. Good tuck.
Okay. All done.
All done, Amelia.
Amelia will do something rather similar to her last turn. She will come approach Metolius, take a spot next to him again, and again kind of raise her hand as she pulls that burning black flame off the dead salamander and sends it streaking towards this one. Okay. And she makes that same flicking motion to cast Toll the Dead.
So flame, hex, preference?
What's that?
You wanted a hex, right?
Yes.
And would you like, what would you like as the modifier to effect?
Oh, do strength.
Okay. And then Toll the Dead, wisdom saving throw on this boy, 19.
Ooh, that makes it so nothing happens.
Okay. We bring it to Metolius' turn. I'm sorry, Amelia, did you have anything else?
Nope, that was it.
Okay. Metolius.
Metolius comes a running. See if he can get there.
Ooh, yeah.
He can. And actually, you can get there and flank. Well, actually, yeah, flank with Rain. So either a 14 or. Well, looks like a 14. Not a natural one. So that would be 14 points of damage for the first strike.
Fourteen points?
Yep.
Okay.
And a 20 for the second strike.
Hits.
And I will put a level 2 Divine Smite into this one. So add another 17 to that 16.
Okay.
So 47 total for my entire round of attacking.
Would you like to do this in a specific way?
Who is the creature facing?
The creature is effectively facing more towards the east, like away from you. He's trying to get away.
Okay, I know what I'll do. Metolius will run up and he'll slash it at the side, and then as it doubles over, he'll just take the axe and plant it in its temple.
Okay.
And the Divine Smite will go off and his head will explode.
Sounds good. Yeah, so you just run up and slash at its side. It reels back, and you just follow through with just sticking it right in the side of its head. And as you do, that radiant glow flows through you, through your axe, and into the creature's just skull, and the thing just bursts with a bright white light as the creature falls. And as the battlefield around you once again goes quiet, except for the bubbling of the two pools and the wind through the mountains.
Is everyone all right?
Yeah,
I'm all right.
Yes, I'm fine.
I'm not doing fantastic, but I'm not bloodied.
I can give you a hand if you need.
Yeah.
I could probably use it.
I, too, have taken several burns, but I can tend to myself.
Amelia will approach Rain then, and she will cast Cure Wounds for 29 hit points.
Perfect.
Ooh. Damn. Spicy.
I am 5 under max now. I'm good.
Word.
Nice. I'm at half health, but I imagine I still have more than you, Rain. So.
Probably.
Vitolius would activate a parabead on his necklace and cast Cure Wounds on himself at level 2.
Okay.
I regain 12.
Amelia is going to walk over to Grimtuck and place a hand on his shoulder and say, I can take care of this right now, but I may need to rest for a moment.
Yeah, I mean, that's fine. I don't think we're in a big rush. I kind of want to figure out what the fuck these guys even wanted.
Then Amelia is going to cast Cure Wounds upon him as well.
Okay.
For 28 hit points.
Damn.
Nice. So yeah, just like on Rain, Amelia touches your shoulder, Grimtuck, and a white light pulses out of her hand and across you, and your wounds begin to close.
All right, feeling better. I want to go about poking around on these guys' corpses to see if there's, like, what the fuck's up. Kind of want to check out their weapons, see what kind of gear they got, like, kind of get an idea for what the fuck they wanted. Like, are they trying to, like, were we food? Did they look like they have, like, I don't know. It's weird that they have weapons, but they live in lava. There's questions, okay. You know?
So, how would you like, who would you like to try to figure this out upon first?
One of the big dudes with the spears.
Okay. Roll a nature check.
Okay.
As people begin to go through things, Amelia just kind of wanders back over to the rock pile she was hiding behind and takes a seat on top of it.
Okay.
Weirdly enough, natural 20.
Excellent. I would say, though you may never have had a connection or an introduction to these creatures prior to this point, you know that kind of baseline tribalistic hunting party-esque, a lot of hiding and springing of basically hiding and springing out upon your prey. So these creatures seem to want to either for game or for food. Nothing else on them except for the spear. They have no pouches, no belts, no bags, no anything. The metal spear.
I'm sorry, go ahead.
Itself is surprisingly well maintained for it being in such hot heat.
What's like the size of the spear? Is it sized for a bigger creature than medium?
It is well sized for this creature, so a large creature.
So like,
but also, I mean, you could, it would definitely be a little unwieldy. You also, as you grab onto it, like, it's still boiling hot. Like,
Just trying to think.
It seems to have cooled down since you've been stabbed with one of these. But it doesn't mean that it is fully cooled down yet. It effectively looks like a winged spear. If
yeah, like a spear that can't be burned up might be pretty useful against those dragons. And these things are big as fuck. These things are like lances or something. But I don't know. It might be. I bet you I could use one.
If you don't think it will trouble you to wield it in battle, I don't see a problem with it.
I mean, like, I'll take it with me and just see what it does. Like, who knows? I'll dick around with it on the way there. I imagine we still got some time to kill before we get to this thing.
You notice also, as you're looking over the spear, it doesn't seem to be made out of... it seems to be made out of a metal.
It doesn't seem to be shiny like a lot of your more enchanted weaponry. Mm-hmm. It just seems to be made out of a metal that seems to hold form, that seems to somehow keep itself from melting in such hot heat.
Would I know of any metals that would sink with that?
Roll me another nature check.
I was gonna say, I'm not the smartest guy, but I know weapons.
Nicolius is going to join.
You're not going to believe this, but another natural 20. Sorry, I didn't mean to interrupt you there, Matt.
Oh, I'm just going to join Amelia and use Lay on Hands to cure some of my burns and begin to bandage my wounds.
In this moment of kind of just trying to figure out, I would say your natural 20 tells you of no metal that you know of that would be able to sit in such hot heat for so long. That is what your natural 20 gives you.
Like, guys, I know a lot of stuff about things we use to kill people, and there aren't any metals I could think of that can just hang out in lava and keep their durability and actually be usable. What the really? Fuck do I think that these metals are made of?
I'm not sure. Let me see it.
I'll hand one over. Like, even if we can't use it, I bet you they're expensive as shit.
Potentially. I would like to give it a long critical eye.
Sure.
Can I learn anything additional from this?
So are you all sitting down for a short rest? Is that what the plan is?
That's Amelia's plan.
Okay. That's fine. You absolutely can do.
Okay. Well, then I will ritually cast Identify on this thing.
Okay.
And learn everything that I can about it.
Excellent. It is a non-magical spear.
Great.
It has no seeming effect that you can tell. Like, let me just double check something. Yep. It is completely mundane. It has no form of magic. It is not magic imbued. And it has no other properties other than being a very good spear.
Well, we should probably move on just in case there's more of them out there as soon as we can.
Agreed.
Yes. Also agreed.
So you all take your short rest.
Yes.
Okay. Feel free to roll any form of hit die if you wish. Do anything else. Obviously, Amelia, you'll gain your spells and stuff back.
Yep. And everybody will gain 10 temp HP.
Nice.
You regain it?
Yep.
Fantastic.
As you all... Did you
what
want
does that
to...
Oops, look like sorry. On it? Like, is that a... Do I feel like a shimmering light around me? Or, like, what is
you,
it?
When it activates, you just see, like, Amelia's eyes flash. And you kind of feel like just this, like... protective essence around you.
Gotcha. Well, I dug it.
Excellent.
Because it ate up all the damages that I took.
That's good. As you all finish out continue the short rest, is there anything anyone else wants to do? Grimtug, are you checking the other bodies?
Yeah, I'm checking other bodies, but also I want to reattune to my bracers of defense.
Okay.
That I got back from Amelia.
Sure.
Just figure we're going to go fight a dragon. It makes sense.
Atolius gets all healed up and is ready to go when everyone else is. Okay.
Same.
Yep.
And Grimtuck, to attune to this, you'd actually have to spend your entire short rest doing this. So I'd say you check this body, but you can't really do anything else.
That's fine.
Okay.
I'll just attune to this then.
Okay. Well, as you attune, you become attuned to your bracers once again, as everyone either heals or gains spells. So, after finishing your short rest, you continue on your hike through these blasted peaks. The those fissures filled with lava and fire appear here and there as you go. But nothing else seems to pull itself out of them. But as you get closer and closer, you start seeing flakes of black kind of pass by your vision as ash begins to rain from the sky as the volcano is still very much alive. You now find yourself at the very base here. I will show you. You find yourself at the very base of the mountain itself, or of the volcano itself. The path wheels around the western edge, rimming. It's a terrible word to say that.
Go on.
No, it was great.
Go on.
Wait, what's happening? Curiosity
piqued.
Excellent. Mm. Shifting around the side, leaving very few, if only, the one way of access. But you continue through, staying away from any water source you see as that same instance of green and orange and sulfur seems to fill every last bit of it. Another one of those rumbles from below the ground hit as you are on the very finite mountain pass around the western side of the volcano. You hold on to the side and pieces of stone come crumbling down, but you are competent in your travels and able to stay standing and continue forward. As you begin to move down the slope towards the southern point of this rocky outcrop, or of this volcano, you see an odd rocky outcropping that stands now almost as though mayhaps one of those rumbles, one of those shocks and shakes that the ground had loosed some large boulders from above, and now these two sit in the way of your path ahead of you. On the opposite side, you almost see the glow of red off in the distance of living liquid rock moving over stone. These two decently sized, probably about maybe like 5 or so feet high boulders kind of block the way. And around it, other rocks sit. Kind of this natural wall.
Is it, in fact, does it look natural or do they look placed?
It looks natural.
Okay.
There's probably about like 10 of these similar size boulders kind of littering the path in front of you, all kind of collected together. Very much blocking the path now.
So there's 10 of them and they're like 5 feet wide?
They're about 5 to 6 feet in like diameter.
Perhaps we should move, put our shoulders to it and move them.
Yeah, let's give it a shot.
Are they easily pushed off the side of the mountain or down out of our way?
I mean, the only way to try it is to test it.
Well, so,
from just looking at it, they look pretty well, like, collected together.
Okay. Well, I will help. I will help the Grimtux.
Yep, let's give it a go.
Every last Grimtux.
All the Grimtux. Yeah.
Both of you.
Sorry.
Oh no! Continue.
Go ahead.
Okay, both of you kind of sidle up next to these boulders and begin to put your back into it. Amelia, what did you?
Just going to say that Amelia is going to look around and see if she can maybe find like some sort of large piece of lumber or something maybe she could use as a wedge to get in between these boulders.
Roll, I literally have a crowbar.
Oh.
If that helps.
These are very big.
I was going
to say you probably wouldn't be able to get enough
actual... But Amelia has her staff, too, but I feel like they might be a little bit too big for that.
Mm. Yeah.
Feel free to roll a perception check, Amelia. To kind of look around.
22.
You look around, and there isn't much vegetation anywhere around the area you're in. Anything you find is sparse and dying, almost burned away from where you are standing.
No large bones or anything like that?
Not around here that you can see. You may have passed them a couple miles back, but in Fair. This area, cleared yeah, almost yeah. Purely so. And as you look around and Rain kind of goes to help, both Grimtuck and Metolius kind of brace up to try to move these out of the way. And a kind of echoing, booming voice kind of chimes out. And you hear, "Go back." It kind of echoes through, and it almost seems like it comes through the stone itself as you're pressing yourself up against it, Grimtuck. "Go back."
Did you... What? The fucking stone?
I think you hear this too. You now hear this too, Metolius, as it says, "Run while you can."
Did this rock just say something, Grimtuck? Is the heat getting to me?
No. I'm pretty sure the rock just told us to piss off.
Well, I'm going to look around. Like, can I see any obvious source of this? Like,
well, you can roll a perception check, but you actually, as you say that, Grimtuck, you hear, "Yes, piss off."
I would laugh at that.
23.
As you laugh,
Amelia would step back away from the boulders at that.
Okay. 23. As you begin to chuckle at that, Grimtuck, do you kind of pull yourself back a little bit?
A little bit, yeah.
All of you, well, Elwyn specifically, Amelia, because you're so far back, you see this as well. You see these two pieces of stone kind of rise up, and it looks kind of like a face for a moment, eyes sunken into black holes, a craggy mouth, and almost like a bridge of a nose, but no actual like physical features other than that, kind of rise up from behind the stone and look down. "I should go back. What he said piss off."
Wait, what the fuck? Why? Why should we go back? Who are you? What are you?
You now see as they uncurl themselves from this almost boulder-like form, these two creatures, probably about 6 feet tall each, large, broad shoulders, standing there, stand atop this pile of boulders in front of you. And as these two creatures stand there, Amelia, you swear that your brain just got smacked as just this pure force of information flows out from it. And you see once again the vision you had before as that monk. Okay. You remember seeing two of these creatures standing within this large cavern, glowing red, and Flair walks by them and wishes them good luck as she moves off towards Saltshire.
Huh. Okay.
You remember them now as her memories still stay well within you.
Do I know their names?
You do. You can tell specifically the cracks are so defined. They look exactly, they haven't changed a bit since Flair saw them last. And their names are Tumo, T-U-M-O, and Bozog, B-O-Z-O-J, or Z-O-G.
B-O-Z-A-G?
O-G.
O-G.
And you see them stand ahead and go,
Wary adventurers, go back. A scourge is beset upon these mountains.
Yeah, no, we're going to go kill that scourge. That's what we're doing.
We are here to face it.
You see those sockets kind of thin, as though it looks quizzical at that statement. It looks over at itself.
Tumo, they wish to kill the molten scourge.
And the other looks over at itself.
No one has succeeded as such, though few have tried. How?
And you see the one that was referenced as Tumo, the one to the right of the pair, kind of looks down upon you and go,
how do you all wish to fight the Scourge? He is a beast of great and awful power.
I don't know, just gonna kill it. How do you kill anything? Like, you know, axes and bows and swords. Just gonna go just fucking kill it. I don't know. Is there a way we should kill it?
Not with fire.
Yeah, not with fire.
You see the other, now the other of the two creatures go,
you believe you could kill it?
I mean, if I'm being really honest here, I'm pretty sure I could kill anything that I put my mind to.
Really love that enthusiasm.
He does really believe it. And we all believe in this case that we are a match for this creature.
Well.
And you see the two of these stone creatures just pull themselves up and over the side and kind of slide down in front. More next to Grimtuck and Metolius now.
Well, we mean you no harm. We only wish to warn anyone of their imminent demise.
Bozog, what happened to this place?
How do you know my name? Tumo, how does she know my name?
I know both of your names before you said them. I once walked in the visions of a woman named Flair.
You see, as much as a rock monster with no actual tear ducts, its eye sockets turn as though eyes tearing up. You see a brow furrow.
We miss Flair. Flair was always very nice to us.
She was quite a woman.
She never returned.
I know.
Not many ever returned after the volcano erupted.
When did that happen?
Years ago. Longer than most smooth and soft skin like you all live. Wait.
And you see the one on the right kind of look over and kind of puts up a hand, and as it does, you see two of the boulders off against the wall kind of do that same effect. They kind of push themselves up and they look like these two creatures, but there's something different. There's something less conscious about them. They look almost more like drones comparatively. And you see the creature go,
move this.
And they do. The other one does the same thing, a second hand wave, and two more. And four of these drones kind of start to push the boulders out of the way and move them, not off the side, but out enough where you notice that behind the boulders against the wall of this pass, there is a cave.
Please, if you know us, then you you know to trust, you will be safe.
Wait, you knew the other heroes?
Like, we know much. We should not stay out in the open. We hide well within rock. You must hide within rock.
Please. Are you guys coming with?
Yes. It is our cave. But you should not stand here.
Amelia moves to go inside.
The red giants that fly. They patrol the area.
There's more than one.
We will talk inside. Please.
Alright, go inside.
Yep.
Yep.
If Amelia trusts them, I will trust them.
Agreed.
Inside of this tunnel, the it is legitimately just a dug-in tunnel into the wall of this mountainside. It doesn't even go on for more than about 30 feet. But it's decently high. It's probably about maybe 9 feet tall. And spreads probably about 15 feet wide. So you all have enough of a breadth to move around in and get far enough down in to stay out of the entryway. And as you all move in, as the two rock creatures move in as well, they almost stand guard with their backs to the entrance. And as they stand there still, it looks as though boulders have covered the entrance, at least to a point. Sealing off, but more so blocking you from sight. And as they do this, you notice the boulders that were moving things cease and just revert back into boulders.
You should be safe here for now. The red-skinned giants cannot see here, will not see you.
Again, you said there's more than one.
There are two who patrol the entrance to the basilica.
Two dragons?
No. No, the Scourge is but one. He was what drove us from our home. Not the lava, not the heat, but the dragon from our duty.
What was your duty?
We were meant to guard the life egg.
Fuck's a life egg.
It is what the basilica is built around.
It's the reason this place is here.
It is what the people who once worshipped and lived here believed in, prayed to, protected.
Is it still here?
Yes. The Scourge has nothing, no care for it, nor could it ever destroy or harm it.
What is the nature of this thing?
And he kind of looks at you.
Which thing?
The life egg. Is that a metaphor, or is it literally an egg?
It is a large, gigantic structure. Egg-shaped and set within the molten pools.
Fantastic. Have you seen it yourself?
It was our job to guard it.
I see.
We did long after the monks left. Long after it was uninhabitable by humans. or soft skins like yourself. But we were driven out of our home.
What can you tell us of what has happened in the time that has passed?
In the time since we have watched out here, creature has gathered wealth and gold, and has gathered followers. It has brought creatures through fire to this place. And it has done terrible things to the lands around. Its thirst, its longing is insatiable. But it believes it to be the rightful owner of this volcano, this land. It is not. What rests within the spirit of the basilica, that is who owns this land.
Who rests within?
A voice once spoke to us, now grows silent. We know not. We were charged to protect it, though. Told the egg was to be protected.
I see.
And what of the pyre mall?
It rests there, still. The dragon sees it as a trophy. Believes it would draw unwitting food and fodder to it.
As can it be used against pass. Him?
I do not know. Not one has ever. In our time.
They almost at this point start speaking in tandem. You hear two voices kind of echoing through. It no longer seems to speak as separate entities, now as a combined force, a combined voice.
But you believe you can destroy this creature, reclaim the basilica, allow its rightful owner to live within once again.
I mean, yeah.
That's our plan.
Or die trying.
We are concerned with that, but hope not. Know that you go in not to just face the dragon, but the creatures of fire who inhabit this land, this area, seem to praise it as a lord or god. Small ones, larger as well. The red giants, too, patrol the entrance for the creature. Inside, a horde of smaller lizard and draconic-like creatures pray to it like a deity.
Hmm. These red-skinned giants, what can you tell us about them? Are they giants or other creatures of flame?
They are both and not. They fly in a spiral of fire, horns atop them and wicked weapons. Fire seems to dance from their hands. Their life itself pulled from a land wreathed in flame. We had seen them appear out of crevices within the ground.
How far is the basilica from where we are now?
No more than just around the bend down the way, less than a mile, if I'm not mistaken. You are close, which is why our position is here. We are set to warn so that more lives are not lost on people who do not know the danger they face.
Well, we are well aware.
Perhaps we should use this opportunity to rest if we're so close and strike at the beast on the morrow when we have all of our capabilities.
Yeah.
I think that's a good idea.
Indeed.
We cannot offer food or drink, but shelter and protection can be done.
I would hear more stories from you of the way the world used to be, if you would be able to tell us.
And Flair.
Yes. Tell us more about what happened.
It was beautiful when it was... when it was new, when it was young. Halls filled with monks in reverence to the egg. Opposition heralded highly among the ones who stayed here. Life can be lived within the basilica if it was not for the scourge or the volcano itself, which had grown active and violent long before the scourge appeared. Sadly, as the monks were driven out, the creature found it and claimed it as its own. As we could not stay, for it would have destroyed us, we ran. But in the time of Flare, people were taught, trained. They lived. They set out to protect the lands. They believed in keeping this area safe. But that was a long time ago now. You have seen through her eyes, though. You know of her doings, of her teachings, of her training. Every one of them were as competent a warrior, as caring a being, and as intelligent of a scholar as Flair herself.
Do any of her orders still live?
If so, they never have returned. They mayhaps have been scattered to the wind like ash and dust. If they do, we can only hope they now live and continue to teach and train.
Do you know of the order known as the Twilight Sword? Did you know of them?
I am sorry. The name was never brought to our attention.
Damn it. What of the being inside the egg you speak of? What is it? It sounds like it shares a connection with flame and fire, but...
We do not know if even it lives now, nor do we know entirely what it is or was. We just know that our task was to protect it with our lives, but a creature such as the Scourge does not allow for such doings. And ours was not one of sacrifice. This, we believe what spoke to us may have been the creature inside. But we are not sure. We do not know. mayhaps ridding this land of the scourge, its voice will become clear once again. If it does, we would be willing to tell you what it says.
Yet another reason to put an end to this beast.
This goes longer and longer.
We would like to be able to go back to our home, back to our job, our life inside, standing watch of the egg. If you and your party can help that, we would be greatly appreciative. We do not have much, but whatever hoard that beast has claimed, we need not of it.
How long has the beast been here?
Many, many seasons.
Kind of looks at you as though the concept of time specifically doesn't exactly flow like that to them. Like, it seems like he's trying to quantify it, but it doesn't seem to click.
But for now, you all should rest. Stay in. We shall turn and watch the skies for the giants.
Sounds as best plan as I can think of right at the moment.
Hey, since you've been here, has this volcano ever erupted?
Yes.
Do you know how many times that's happened since you've been here? Or since the dragon's been here?
Since we have been here, it was the main reason the monks had fled. The dragon has allowed it to occur at least, I believe it has been once, if not twice. The creature's mere presence roils the land and shakes it to its core.
Thank you.
Yes.
You also see one arm kind of sticks out from its like boulder-like form and does its best to draw a figure in the sand at its feet. And you see this very humanoid shape with odd little horns upon its head, a long curved blade, and a muscular form, and goes, "This is the creature, the giant." Feel free to roll a nature check. I would say a disadvantage. Or no, just a pure nature check from what they explained.
I would have got 15.
Amelia got an 11.
Yeah. Elduin, Rain?
With disadvantage, you said?
No, just pure, straight across
21.
The board.
21.
A natural 20. Four. What is my nature? 2. Yeah, 22 altogether.
Mayhaps for you, Rain, in stories that you had been told, and Elduin, in your studies, the creature it has drawn out seems to be an Ifrit. A terrible creature, specifically to you, Elduin, from the Plane of Fire.
Yeah.
This is the creature that stays watch for the beast.
A terrifying and wondrous creature of fire. It is not surprising that there has been such turbulent activity as these things are capricious. Of course, based on what I've read.
Well, then we should make it every effort to end them quickly and not prolong the battle.
Yes.
You... If we could somehow get the element of surprise, maybe that could help.
Yeah.
Would I know much about an Ifrit's capabilities?
I would say even both of you with a pretty high nature roll, 15 and natural 20 respectively, I would say other than a somewhat control of fire and flame, probably not.
Okay.
These creatures are powerful, but you're not exactly sure how far that power goes.
Are they like pretty magical, or are they more of like a, like trying to smash you with stuff? Like, what are we thinking?
You would know they have a control of magic in some form or shape.
And they said they fly.
I mean, not a lot of things fly. You got wings.
These do not fly with wings.
Oh, all right.
Well, okay. Then we will be ready for them. And perhaps if we can catch them in some sort of surprise, then that might be worth looking into.
Agreed.
These are the honor guard of the dragon. They are vicious warriors. Your guard is what you should be on.
Honor guard, huh? I mean, like, if I challenge them to like a duel or something, and they gotta like duel me, like, are they like honorable?
What? I know not exactly what honor in it is. It is more what you would call the protectors, the strongest of the dragon's force, or strong of the dragon's force. I do not know if it would duel you. I do not believe it would, but I do not know.
Oh. Never mind.
They're probably as honorable as fire is. So it seems random and chaotic, more so than an honor bound being. But that is just a guess.
Well, would anyone else like to do anything before the night comes and you all take a rest?
Nah.
Prepare for tomorrow, excuse me.
Boulder Bro snooze time.
Well, as you Boulder Bro snooze, I say we're going to call it for this time and pick it up next time.
Yeah.
Sounds
good.
Boulder Bros.
Boulder Bro snooze. Yeah, Boulder Bro.
Hello, adventurers! Dix here. Thank you for listening to another episode of the Swordcast Adventures. Be sure to check out our website, www.swordcastadventures.com, for maps and extra content from our episodes. You can also follow us on Facebook, Twitter, and Instagram, all at the Swordcast, and you can also follow me on Facebook and Twitter at JustTheDix. If you are into even more bonus content, you can go to patreon.com/theswordcast, where for only $5, you can listen to Matt Allspach DM some of the cast through the Tomb of Annihilation. Also, make sure to check out the DM Advice Podcast, Help Action, where myself and three other DMs sit down every other week and spend our turn giving you advantage on your role-playing experience by answering your questions about D&D. The next episode of the Swordcast Adventures will be releasing Monday, October 5th. That's all for now, and thanks again for listening.